Grace, mercy, and peace be multiplied unto each of you from the God and Father of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Listen, beloved, I'm so excited to be here today on this first Sunday of Advent, a season where we anticipate and we expect the coming of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. We know that he was born between animals, and yes, he died between two thieves, but he rose early on the third day morning with all power in his hand. And we are looking forward to that second coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today is the Sunday of hope. The liturgical color is purple for this particular Sunday with the Advent candles. And so we are in hope. Hope is the expectation of future good. And we thank God for that he has given us a lively hope in his Son, Jesus Christ. A hope that we can put our faith and trust in. A hope that will never leave us nor forsake us. A hope that we can depend on. Beloved, I have received some special prayer requests, and I want to, amen, take this time, amen, to go to our God and our Christ before our preaching moment in prayer. We want to, amen, lift up in prayer one of our members, Sister Catherine Davis, our brother-in-law, Derek McLeod, also our good friend and brother Spence Mullis. Also, we want to lift up the Coombs family in prayer. In their time of bereavement, one of our co-workers there. And if you'll be so kind, beloved, anybody else that is in need of prayer, will you go to God in prayer with me at this time? God, our Father, our making creator, we come to you because you are sovereign, you are holy, you are our God and our Father. God, our dependency is on you. We stretch ourselves out on you today, God, for healing, oh God. We pray, God, that your healing virtues will saturate bodies all over this land and country, God, that you will restore bodies to wholeness and a sound and pristine health. God, that you will guide the doctors and the nurses that they labor by bedsides, oh God. And Father, that medicine would do what it's intended to do and medical equipment would do what it's intended to do. God, we put our trust, our hope in you, God. Father, we know that our hope will not be ashamed. God, we confess you as God, our Father, our Christ, the Holy Spirit who guides and comforts us. God, we need you now. And we thank you because our victory is in Jesus. Thank you, O God. You said, let them, O God, who might be sick and weakly among us, O God, come to the elder of the church, O God. Let them anoint them with oil and lay hands on them, God. And so we do that, in, oh God, symbolically here, God. And we know that the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous avail much. So God, we pray that we are in right standing with you, God, and that these prayers would avail much, oh God. Oh God, bless this nation, bless this country. Bless everybody during this time of peril, pandemic, and pandemonium is our prayer. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Thank you, beloved, for going to God and our Christ in prayer and believing prayer. With us today. I'm so excited again this first Sunday of Advent, and we want to you to grab your copy of God's Word. I'll be in several different books today. I want to, amen, talk to you, amen, about these gifts that Jesus Christ gives today. I want to talk to you about gifts that Jesus Christ gives today, and I want to talk to you, amen, from about five different passages of Scripture. And so if you would get your copy of God's Word and go ahead and meet me there in Matthew chapter number 1, verse 23. Child of God, what are we giving Jesus? What do we owe to him? Are we giving all to him? What gifts are we giving to him? We know that he was certainly born between animals, and he died between two thieves on our behalf. He gave us life, and that life more abundantly. But what should we give Jesus? What do we owe to him? The little girl was sitting in church with her mother, and the preacher had preached and about giving their life to Christ and giving their self to God. And so, as often would and parents do, they give their children money to put an offering plate. And so as the plate was coming down the aisle, the mother went to give the little girl money, and she said, no, mom, I don't I don't need that. I have a better gift that I want to give Jesus today. I have something more than this dollar that you're trying to give me. And so as the usher passed the little plate, the person next to the girl passed her the plate, and she did something that just was amazing to this entire congregation. She placed the plate on the floor, and she stood in the middle of the offering plate. And the mother said, "Well, what are you doing, baby?" She said, "I'm giving myself to God." Beloved, will you give yourself to God during this Advent season? Will you give yourself to God during this time of great expectation of the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Will you give yourself to God during this Yuletide season? Will you give yourself to God this Christmas? Because God has given us an unspeakable gift, a gift that is immeasurable. I want to talk to you today about at least five gifts that Jesus gives. I want to, again, talk about gifts that Jesus Christ gives. Gifts that Jesus Christ gives. I know you've been Black Friday online shopping and might have been imperfect. Please be safe if you're in person now. But I want to talk about the gifts that Jesus has available for us. At least five gifts that Jesus gives. Gift number one, or point number one, if you would. I want to talk about the gift of his presence. Will you pick your feet up, because I won't be long today. Matthew 1 and 23. "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us." Child of God, notice the last three words of Matthew 1 and 23. God with us. Does your Bible read like mine? Amen. And as I say these words one more time, I want you to allow these words to resonate in your heart, mind, and soul, and spirit. Listen, friends, God with us. Can I play that for you again? God with us. God with us. In other words, child of God, as I look at this text, amen, it suggests to you and I, friends, that Christmas means that we are no longer alone because we have God with us. We do not have to face the cares, the problems, the trials, the tribulations of life with our own resources, nor the resources of others, because we have God with us. Yeah, God himself, amen, wrapped, amen, divinity and humanity, amen, and took a 9-month train and was born in Bethlehem between the angels, because God wanted to move closer with us. This God that was in the burning bush with Moses decided to get a little closer to us, and he was born in a manger and wrapped in swaddling clothes. And man, and then when he died, amen, on yonder's cross, amen, he ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father, amen. But he did not leave this comfortless. He gave the precious gift of the Holy Spirit, who dwells on the inside of us, amen. So God is still with us. Beloved, the gift that Jesus gives, number one, point number one, is the gift of his presence, is it not? Oh, I'm so glad that he lives on the inside of us. I'm so glad that, like grandma say, that he walks with us. He talks with us. He tells us that we are his own. The old preacher would call him our burden bearer, the heavenly load sharer. The old preacher would describe the Holy Ghost, amen, as our company keeper. In other words, he was simply trying to let us know that God is with us, regardless of what you're going through, regardless if you got more money than money. I want to suggest to you today that God is with you, regardless of if you lost your loved one, amen, and you're feeling sad during this season, amen, amen. I want to let you know that God is with you. The Bible says that he will never leave you, nor will he forsake you. Regardless if you're on the mountain high or you're in the valley low, I want to submit and to suggest that you have the gift of the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, amen. All you got to do is call him and tell him what you want, because God is with us. Be not dismayed, whatever betide. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings a love abide. He will take care of you. Child of God, regardless of what it looks like, God is with you. And if you can take it, you can make it. Amen. Won't you put your hope and trust in a God, amen, who loved you so much that he decided to come down through 42 generations just to be with you, just to see about you, just to hold you, just to keep you. Child of God, God is with you. What a precious gift during this Christmas time from our God and our Christ, the gift of his presence. But not only do we see the gift of his presence today, the second gift I want to suggest that Jesus gives, the gift that Jesus gives to you, Jesus gives his sympathy, does he not? When you walk around Hebrews 4, 15 through 16 with me, as we look at this gift of his sympathy, and I'm in the English Standard Version, the Bible says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." Let me play that for you again, Hebrews 4, 15 and 16. "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need." Here unequivocally, we see point number two, the gift of his sympathy. Not only did Jesus give us during this time and throughout all time, the gift of his presence, the second thing we see here is the gift of his sympathy. Here's the interrogative, beloved. Have you ever, amen, been going through a situation, a trial, a test, something difficult, amen, and you desired, you long, amen, to talk to someone, amen, else who knows exactly how you feel, someone who knows what it feels like to be in the midst of their own pandemic time, someone knows who knows that, amen, the foxes have houses, but the Savior had nowhere to lay his head, someone who knows what it feels like to be evicted when there's no room in the inn, amen, or homeless, amen, someone who knows what it's like to be poor and in need. Someone knows who knows what it feels like when a loved one gone, because amen, when Jesus wept, amen, he was felt so sad when his friend Lazarus died. Someone who is able, amen, to sympathize with whatever you have going on in your existential reality. Child of God, here it is. Not only did Jesus come to us, but the Bible teaches us that he cares for us. Can I play that again? Not only did Jesus come to us, the Bible teaches us that he cares for us. Amen. The text says, amen, amen, he felt what we feel. Amen. Amen. He allowed himself to be tempted with the same temptations, amen, that you and I go through. He experienced bereavement and he wept, amen, at the loss of a loved child of God, amen. Jesus has gone through everything that you and I have gone through. He's endured the lust of the eyes. He's endured the lust of the flesh. He's endured the pride of life when the devil tried to tempt him and stop him and take him. I want to suggest to you today that regardless of what you're going through today, Jesus is able to sympathize with your situation. He knows how to be rich. He knows how to be poor. Amen. He knows how to be hungry. Amen. He knows how to be well fed. Jesus knows, and he's able to identify with you. Yeah, you on the phone, you on your tablet, you on your computer. Amen. He can identify with you, amen, exactly where you are, just like you are, and who you are. He is a high priest who sympathizes with us. So let us come boldly, amen, before the throne of grace. And then the text teaches us, amen, he invites us to cast our cares upon him because he cares for you. He wants to sympathize with you. He's giving you the gift of his sympathy right now. Will you accept this great high priest? Will you accept the gift of his presence? Will you accept the gift of his sympathy? But the third gift, amen, that Jesus gives us that I want to point out that you need to take, amen, and consideration and advantage of during this season is the gift of his peace. Will you walk around Luke, the second chapter, the 14th verse with me? Luke chapter number 2 and verse number 14, the English Standard Version. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased. Not only does he give us the gift of his presence, not only does he give us the gift of his sympathy, but here in Luke 2 and 14, the text suggests to us that Jesus Christ gives us the gift of his peace. Will you say that to your own self? Jesus Christ gives me the gift of his peace. Child of God, you can't get a gift unless you receive a gift. Will you walk around the B clause of Luke 2 and 14 with me? And on earth, peace among those with whom he is pleased. Notice that the angels here in the text are the first. They said it first, that Jesus' birth brought us peace, did it not? And I'm so glad that he brought us peace that passeth all understanding when we should be losing our doggone mind. He is able to keep us when we can't keep ourselves. No wonder Isaiah said in 9:6, amen, he referred to him as the Prince of Peace. He is peace. He owns peace. Amen. He exudes with peace. Will you accept that peace of God that passeth all understanding? Will you pass on that peace? I like the way Paul said it, y'all. Amen. He says through Jesus Christ, we have both peace with God in Romans 5:1. Amen. And then over in Philippians 4:7, he says, not only do we have, amen, the peace of God in Romans, peace with God in Romans 5:1, we have the peace of God in Philippians 4:7. Are you with me? He gives us the peace with him, and he gives us the peace that's of him. And I like that, y'all, because when I was a little boy in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, there in the choir, amen, we had Miss Hearns and amen, and Miss Bell and amen, and Miss Mae Jenkins, amen, and they used to teach me this song. It goes a little like this: let there be peace on earth, amen, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be with God as our Father. Brothers, all are we. Let me walk with my brother in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me. Oh, shucks in here. Is there anybody here that thinks that we need peace during this mundane circumvention in 2020, amen, that we're living in? Is there anybody think that we need the peace of God that passes all understanding? Is there anybody who's willing and listening and watching and able who will accept this gift of peace from God so that they can re-gift and give that peace? Is there anybody who don't mind shouting, let there be peace on earth? Somebody else shouting, let it begin with me. Not only do we have the gift of his presence, not only during this Advent season do we have the gift of his sympathy and the gift of his peace. The fourth gift that I want to leave with you, amen, comes from 2 Corinthians 5:21. Point number 4, I want to give you the gift of his righteousness. Oh, it's in the text. Will you take my hand, be my friend, and walk around 2 Corinthians 5:21 with me? For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Let me play that for you again. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Child of God, 2 Corinthians 5:21 is one of the most amazing verses in the Bible to me. Can I tell you why? Because predicated upon this text, not only did Jesus take our sin on himself at yonder's cross, but he gives you and I, he gives us his very righteousness when we trust in him as our Savior. Isn't that an awesome gift? That we are guilty as charged, yet when we put our trust in him, he gives us the gift of righteousness in him. This word righteousness means, and righteous simply means right standing with God. Amen. The Bible also speaks in the Old Testament how our righteousness is as a filthy rag. And the rags referred to were the rags that women used during their menstrual cycles. And we know the purpose of those rags was to be covered with the blood. In other words, we do not have right standing in God unless we're covered with the blood. So I thank God for 2 Corinthians 5:21. For our sake, he allowed him to be sin who knew no sin. In other words, he shed his blood on the cross and he died for your sins and mine. And because we put our trust in him, we are covered with the blood. And as the text says, amen, that in him we might become righteousness. I thank God that he has given us the gift of righteousness, of right standing. Oh, it was nothing that we deserved on our own. We were all sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. We were all very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea, he heard our despairing cry. And from sinful waters, he lifted you and I, and now safe we are. Yes, it was the love of God that lifted us into righteousness with him. Who wouldn't accept the gift like that? A gift that'll chase you down to save you and turn around and bless you. What a gift, what a gift, what a gift. Not only do we have the gift of his presence. If you don't get any other gifts, you're going to get these five. All you got to do is talk to Jesus and accept him. Not only, amen, do we have the gift of his presence during this time of year. Not only do we have the gift of sympathy during this time of year and all year. Not only do we have the gift of his peace and the gift of his righteousness. Amen. We also have, yes, the gift of eternal life. Let me say that again. We also have the gift of eternal life. According to John, amen, chapter 10:28. Yes, and I'm in the English Standard Version of God's unsearchable writ. The Bible says, I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. Somebody said the gift of eternal life. Let me play this scripture for you again. And I want you to get this. And I don't want you to miss this. What an amazing gift. If you don't get one gift under the tree, you got these five. But here's an unspeakable gift. Here's an awesome gift in John 10:28. And don't miss it. Listen carefully here. Jesus says, I give them eternal life. And that means along with eternal life, they will never perish. And along with eternal life and never perishing, no one, no devil in hell, no hater that you have, no one will be able to snatch them out of my hand. Nothing or no one can snatch you out the hand of God. When you are saved and you are truly saved, you are saved. Somebody shout hallelujah. Nothing can steal your salvation, because what's in God's hand will never perish. What's in God's hand has eternal life. And what's in God's hand, nobody can snatch it out. Jesus says to us in the text, he gives eternal life. Jesus says to us in the text, we will never perish. Jesus says to us in the text, no one will be able to snatch us out of his hand. Does your Bible read like mine? Child of God, this text to us suggests that Jesus didn't come to be some mere token of God's love to mankind, but he came to give you and I eternal life, did he not? Matthew 1 and 21 says he came to save his people from their sins. Will you accept the gift? The only way you can get the gift is you have to accept the gift today. He came to pay for the obstruction, amen, in our relationship with Jesus Christ, that thing that was blocking us, that barrier that was in the way, that barricade that was preventing us from God, and that barrier is sin. Sin separates us from God. He came to be the propitiation of our sin. Amen. And what this gift of eternal life cost Jesus shows us his amazing love for us, because this salvation might be free, but it's certainly not cheap. It cost Jesus his very life. His blood had to be shed so that you and I can go free from sin, and that we can have eternal life, amen, that we will never perish, and that nothing can take us out of his hand. No wonder the Apostle Paul, who never got over the wonder of his own salvation, spent the rest of his time, amen, talking about salvation in Jesus Christ alone and bringing this news of salvation to others. No wonder he would write this in 2 Corinthians 9 and 15. Thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. Hallelujah for the unspeakable gift of our God, amen, which is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the thing I like about it, every gift that Jesus gives is himself anyway. When he gives a gift, it's really himself. He gives us his presence. He gives us his sympathy. He gives us his righteousness. Amen. He gives us his peace. And he gives us eternal life. Will you accept the gift that Jesus gives? And then when you accept that gift, will you re-gift it so that somebody else can experience the hope, the love, the peace, and the joy that only can come from Jesus Christ? Will you accept these gifts that Jesus gives, regardless of when sadness comes in, or because of bereavement and mourning tries to set in, or our bodies doesn't feel the best because of what we're going through physically or health-wise? Will you accept the gift of peace and joy and love and happiness when the world is treating you with so much hate? Will you accept the gift that Jesus gives? Because love covers a multitude of sin. And what we need more now in this world is love. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. The first commandment and the second is just like it. Oh, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift, Jesus. Will you accept him today? He hung, he bled, and he died for your sins. Born in a manger in Bethlehem. Amen. Ministered in Jerusalem, crucified and died on Calvary for your sins and mine, and coming back again. Will you allow Jesus to be Lord of your life? If you're here today and you have never accepted any of these gifts, particularly the gift of salvation, will you bow with me? Lord, here am I. I'm coming to receive eternal salvation through hope and trust and belief in your Son, Jesus Christ. I confess that he is Lord to the glory of God the Father. I am saved and I am truly saved. Amen. Listen, beloved, if you prayed that prayer, hallelujah, welcome to God's forever family. Let me read that scripture to you again so you can just hear it. I give them eternal life, John 20, 10 and 28, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of our hand. Beloved, when you are saved and truly saved, you can be no more unsaved than water can fall out of a well. Hallelujah, you're saved. Maybe you're here today, friends, and you're just dealing with the emotions and the roller coaster of life. Will you go to God with me? Because he says he gives us that gift of peace and that right standing. Will you bow with me and believe in prayer? Lord God, I've sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Help me to experience your joy. Help me to experience your peace. Help me to bask in your presence. Thank you for sympathizing with my infirmities and my weakness. Thank you for allowing me to be in right standing with you. God, I thank you for peace and I thank you for eternal life. Order my steps in your word. Lead me and guide me every day. Send your anointing, Father, I pray. Order my steps in your word, please, Jesus. Thank you for loving me and help me to share that love and you and your love to others. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Listen, beloved, hey, we love you. We appreciate you. Want to thank all of those for your well wishes during my wife and I's anniversary time together. Again, this is the Advent season. Next Sunday will be Communion Sunday. Please get your grape juice and crackers. If you don't have that, water, bread, whatever you have, we'll pray over it, bless it, and the Lord knows our heart. Listen, we're still trying to stay safe during this time of pandemic. Let's make sure that we're being responsible. Please read the information in our bulletin on how to stay safe in different scenarios. Please, it's very challenging to stay safe, but please, let's make sure we're doing everything that we can. Wearing our masks, washing those hands, and appropriate social distancing. And let's be mindful of this time that we're in. And let's trust in God that no evil will befall us, neither any plague will come near our dwelling, and that we all will stay free from the virus. God bless you. We love you. May heaven smile upon you. Can't wait to, amen, celebrate the Lord's table with you on next Sunday. And at this time, let us now prepare for our announcement from the Bible.
Greetings from the news desk at Turkey Creek Missionary Baptist Church, where Dr. Frederick C. Williams is the pastor. My name is Devonna Watson, and I am here to bring you this week's news from the Creek. Monday prayer line will be at 7 a.m. and 9 p.m. The toll-free number is 1-302-202-1110. The conference code is 777-581. And now for this week's prayer request.
This week's prayer request, we have Annie L. Lowry, Osnola Davis, Mother Christine Baker, Hattie Thomas, Marie Smith, Martha Farmer, Lucille Collins, Latrell Roach, Joyce Tyson Williams, all PK through 12 and college students, Vaughn London, Pat Rooks, Victoria Wright, Rosa Lee Simmons, McKinley Williams, Mary Mitchell, Brittany Paldo, Wilbert Roberts, Ella Lee Way, Mary Edwin, Stevie Ward, James Cartwright, Carla Cartwright, Deacon Richard Hunter, Brother Wes Moy, Catherine Davis, Ortiz Frazier, Spence Mullis, Ernestine Woodard, Quincy Woodard, Ricky Million, Derek McLeod, Wanda Parker, and the Jennifer Hathaway Combs family.
And now for this week's birthdays.
Today, we'd like to wish a very happy birthday to Catherine Davis, November 29th.
And now for this week's anniversary.
To Larry and Bessie Butts, November 29th. This week's anniversaries, we have Deacon William and Gwendolyn Burwell, November 30th. Friends, it is giving time. There are three ways to give tithes and offerings to the Creek. The first, you may mail your gifts to 1164 Williwood Road, East Dublin, Georgia, 31027. Or you may use our Cash App. Our cash tag is the $ lowercase TCMBC828. Again, our cash tag is the $ lowercase TCMBC828. You may also give by logging on to our secure website, www.turkeycreekbaptistchurch.org, and click on the giving link. Then follow the easy instructions on the screen. Again, log on to our secure website, www.turkeycreekbaptistchurch.org, and click on the giving link. Then follow the easy instructions on the screen. Please remember, Paul told the Corinthians church in 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, verses 6 through 7, in the English Standard Version. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one of us must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Thank you for sharing in your giving.
Here's a spiritual challenge for you. Will you commit to praying for the salvation of one lost person and seek opportunities to share the gospel with him or her? It can be a friend, relative, co-worker, classmate, or acquaintance. It can even be an enemy. After all, Jesus did tell us to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us in Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. Pray and invest in one person the Lord places on your heart that needs Christ. Make a commitment today. Identify your one. Begin praying daily for your one and seeking opportunities to tell them about Jesus and invite them to church. Will you commit? Who's your one?
November 29th is the first Sunday of Advent. Please be sure to celebrate Advent with us at the Creek. Advent is a season of the liturgical year observed in many Christian churches as the time of expectant waiting and preparation for both the celebration of Nativity of Jesus at Christmas and the return of Jesus at the Second Coming. In the New Testament, this is the term used for the Second Coming of Christ. So join us at the Creek as we celebrate the coming of Jesus into the world over the next 4 Sundays and weeks of Advent as we prepare for the second coming of Jesus Christ and remember the real meaning of Christmas.
Next Sunday, we will celebrate the Lord's table. Please have your sacraments ready prior to service as we observe Holy Communion.
This has been your weekly news from the Creek. My name is Devonna Watson, and I hope to see you all next Sunday. Have a blessed day.
Thank you, Devonna. Amen. At this time, let us receive our benediction. Beloved, please accept the gifts that Jesus gives, the gift of his presence. Amen. The gift of his peace. Amen. The gift of his righteousness. Amen. And the gift of salvation. Let us accept all of these gifts that Jesus gives. Amen. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. The Lord lift his countenance upon you, be gracious unto you, and give you peace. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Beloved, we love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Have a blessed day.